a Kilombo village, a place where black people can meet and talk about issues of blindness. He is also an author of the book Disband the White Church. He is the spokesperson for Black Solidarity Action Campaign and has founded campaigns like Welcome to Hell, South African Townships, and Buy Black End White Arrogance Campaign. He caused a stir in the Christian circles where he denounced Christianity in 2016 on the most sacred Christian holiday, Easter. He contributes periodically to local newspapers like Ghana, City Vision, and several other national columns. Please welcome onto stage, Pastor Xola Skosana.
Decolonization is a violent process. unless yours is to manicure and reform the world and not uproot it. In the language of the Bible, well, you can take a person out of the church, but you can never take the church out of the person. So I guess I have a lot of church inside of me still. In the language of the Bible, decolonization is a process of uprooting, tearing down, destroying, and overthrowing to build and to plant. That's a reference in Jeremiah 1. Not to build first, but to uproot first. You can be sure when you do that, next price will throw you in jail. You mess your life around and then call for a TRC. The world as we know it is an anti-black world. A world that has shamed and vulgarized our existence beyond measure. We must look deep into its past and present and see its atrocities for what they really are. To use the phrase in the Lord's Prayer, it is a world that has sinned against us. But unlike the Lord's Prayer, though, this world has sinned an unpardonable sin against us. There can be no forgiving of it. There can be no reconciling to it. It has brutalized and stigmatized us to no end. It must end. Let me use the next few minutes and focus our attention, or refocus our attention, at our disfigurement to show the black story in its crudest form, so that in our process of naming or renaming, we do not end up recreating the very same world we meant to end. People who do not do the work of looking deep into their past end up recreating it. Go visit Joe Slaw in former settlements in London, or Tabon Bay squatter camp on your way to Kailicha in Lansdowne. In my travel in the Northern Cape recently, I saw one informal settlement called Tuima Donzela. What kind of a new world is this? New names, but everything else remains old. You rightly pointed out in your initial correspondence to me that post-1994 has had an entire stream of renaming various parts of our country, including institutions, and to a large extent without addressing the infrastructure that operates in these spaces and places. Here is a warning from Andrew Carr. In an interview, Alexander Holloway asked him the question about tolerance, and I quote, "In Dr. Hughes, you talk about avoiding the liberal trap of tolerance, of compassion and respect. And you concluded by saying that the greatest crime of joyousness is tolerance. Can you explain what you mean, particularly for those who might value tolerance as a virtue?" So Cup responds, it says, and I quote, "Among the many followers of the news today, there are a number of liberal delusions. Perhaps the biggest stronghold is in political science, where there is a committed group of self-professed radical liberals. Another strain bridges the news with the liberalism of John Rawls. I was a bit shocked to discover both of these approaches, but I suppose it was inevitable given the liberalism's ability to assimilate nearly any form of thought." Herbert Marcus recognized repressive tolerance has the incredible power of liberalism to justify the violence of positions clothed as neutral. Examples, marker sites, governments who say they respect democratic liberties because they allow political protests, although they ignore protesters by labeling them a special interest group. End quote. Now, more closer to our discussion, maybe I should add this last line. It says, for those of us who have been who have seen university administrations calmly collect student demands, they set up dead-end committees and slap pictures of protesters on promotional materials as a badge of diversity. That's the last part of that quote. Now, you've invited me to help you think through this moment, and I want to do just that. In thinking through, we must not look in images of grandeur and power, but images of powerlessness and brokenness. We must look deep in the past and cringe in disbelief, but resolve to commit ourselves afresh to the noblest cause of our lives, that of ending the world as we know it. It is my contention that the version of the black story making rounds has become too familiar and only served to neutralize and domesticate us. Those who tell our story leave us who suffer the burden of being black in the world docile. If we agree that the primary charge we lay at the feet of the world is that black existence is the edifice upon which all else stands, if we agree that our impairment and brokenness as black people is a result of having been made the pedestal on which all else holds firm and solid, a weight so heavy that it renders every generation of black people disfigured, then we must bear our soul, not to plead for sympathy, but to demand justice for the crime committed against us. It is said that the pen is mightier than the sword. Like many other things of profundity attributed to white people, these words are attributed to an English author, Edward Bulwer, of words, Bulwer Lytton. This is the contribution I also hope to make in my lifetime to employ the most graphic of words and images that I can master in any language that lends itself useful to retell the story of our vulgarized existence. Vulgar, the hallmark of black identity and religion, is in fact my research topic, my doctoral studies with the University of KwaZulu-Natal. Well, in my notes, I just said in the University of KwaZulu. In the spirit of naming and renaming, I dare not say KwaZulu-Natal, for when the day of reckoning has finally come, there will be no Natal in Azania. Let me quickly acknowledge before I move on, in this paper I'm indebted to thinkers and scholars such as Achille Mbembe, a philosopher, political theorist, and public intellectual from Cameroon, in particular his paper on the post-colony. Here Mbembe uses the words vulgar and grotesque to critique post-colonial societies. Orlando Peterson, Slavery and Social Death. Here is laid bare the intrusive manner by which a person is turned into a slave and a permanent mark of such violence. Not only does one forever live with general dishonor, alienation to self, and vulnerability to violence, their offspring is born an enemy within the dominant culture. Though I'm not fond of giving credit to white people, let me acknowledge David Chester, who is the professor of religious studies here at UCT. He has documented the emergence of a science of comparative religion in Great Britain during the first half of the 19th century and its complex relations to the colonial situation in South Africa. I have found in particular the records of encounters of Europeans with savage cultures helpful. The disdain suffered by the indigenous people in these early encounters is the same disdain suffered by black people who inhabit the world today, including those certified to live temporarily in spaces of white privilege. And of course, the great God himself, Bantu Biko, a man whose wisdom remains unmatched, to quote the words of a song by Emmy Grant or the Book of Psalms, "Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path." Here is a story of Mr. Hamilton Naki, probably familiar to some of us. What I hope will be highlighted in the story is the vulgarized black existence, both the body and the spaces of human settlement we are subjected to. The story will hopefully show the cumbersome representation of blackness in the world, one that is seemingly incurable even beyond the notable successes of black people in areas of art, sport, academia, and practically every human endeavor recorded in history. This story emerged in our locality. We look in the archives and find a Christian Bernard, a white cardiac surgeon, who is said to have performed the world's first human heart transplantation in 1967. In his shadows, we find a Hamilton Naki, a laboratory assistant with exceptional surgical skills, who took a leading role in organ transplant, transferring such skills both to physicians and medical students alike. When the story of Christian Bernard broke, Mr. Naki got relegated to the dustbin of history for almost 40 years until shortly after his retirement. Only then was he recognized for his contribution in the medical field, receiving an honorary degree in Masters of Science from the University of Cape Town in 2003. A face-saving act, it seems, and a question of too little, too late. I say so because Mr. Naki was given the Bronze Order of Makhubu by President Thabo Mbeki in a year before already. Now, vulgar is embodied and it is sensory. It is something that we see, taste, or touch that nauseates us to our last nerve. Mr. Naki was a victim of a vulgarized black existence who lived in the shadows of whiteness. Vulgar is the inescapable hallmark of black identity. What is ugly, repulsive, and distorted, what lacks sophistication and good taste, is now permanently black identity the world over. Not even Oprah or Michelle Obama have been able to escape unscathed. Blacks have lived in bodies and subjected to spaces that have been systematically vulgarized for far too long. Such vulgar has now intricately and inescapably become one with us. To be black in the world, in the eyes of others, is to be tasteless, undefined, loud, overdone, and over-elaborate. It is to be impolite, ill-mannered, uncultured, and low-minded. Black existence can be likened to someone giving it off a fort. Is the fort? Fort. Some people give it fort like a fort. Sorry. Thank you. Now, I thought this would go, Now, black existence can be likened to someone giving off a fart, a natural and healthy emission of wind through the anus, but stricken with so much guilt They start apologizing to every stranger that passes by. John, where am I? We must fight. And fight hard. In Achille Mbembe's words, even by the act of laughter and ridicule, people kidnap power and force it, as if by accident, to examine its own vulgarity. Now, Loison Kota and Andilele, the leaders of this corner, a protest movement in Khayelitsha, will forever be remembered for leading a poor throwing campaign. Who can forget the pictures of human waste strewn around at the entrance at Cape Town International Airport? Or the security personnel running for cover as human excreta was being thrown at the entrance of the provincial legislature? The picture of Sir John Rowe, decorated in human feces by Umani Makhubu, is etched in our collective memory. All these acts of courage and bravery have something to teach us about vulgar as protest. They remain the most creative and provocative forms of protest post 1994. Here's that word. Warm-ups. Or warmth. And trans bodies and trans bodied activists laid bare at the entrance of the gallery where Roads Must Fall and Fees Must Fall exhibition was taking place in 2016, successfully interrupting and ending what Mr. Kasile had put together as the archives of Roads Must Fall. They contested the erasure of woman. And the erasure of bodies with complex gender identities in telling the story of Arnhem. They threw their naked bodies at the door, insisting in a powerful symbolic gesture that their bodies don't matter and therefore visitors to the exhibition can jump over them and not be bothered. Now these acts have the ability to tame power and render it impotent. Was it not the vulgarized black existence that Biko sought to rescue blacks from when he presented a counter-narrative contesting that black is beautiful? Biko said that which is vulgar and obscene in the eyes of others is in fact beautiful in our eyes. Biko taught us that if we are going to survive the insult on our bodies and the assault on the black psyche, our vulgarized presence in the world must be a form of protest against and a refuge from the dominant culture. As a way of conclusion, let me say that in some small way, we at Way of Life, now known as Kilombo, have sought to kidnap power for 6 years consecutively. We have walked the 11.5 kilometers from Gule to Khayelitsha under the banner "Welcome to Air" South African townships, carrying the crucifix in a performative way and as a symbol of vulgarized black existence. Now the biblical story, fictional or not, is the closest gruesome act of violence that people wake up to in the townships of South Africa. A daily near-death experience. Mr. Nagri in one of these rat-infested arrows called Langa embodied its vulgar and its smell of death as he walked into the laboratory every day, while Christian Bernard could sleep peacefully in his 45 little white enclave outside which blacks like Mr. Nagy fed the garbage beans. Now, how could anyone think of him any better or even acknowledge him for his genius when in his body he fully represented vulgarity? Black students in this institution must wage war against all forces that seek to dominate us as black people, including workers and lecturers, whether it comes in the form of signage and symbols or its infrastructure and content. In this process, do not take upon yourself an extra burden of trusting or humanizing whites. Let them prove their worth not by their rhetoric, but by their action. Until then, follow the example of Biko, who left the liberal politics of white-led Nusas in 1968 and took as a sacred spear black consciousness. You must understand that you are black and deliberately vulgarized to humanize others. As Biko aptly put it, and I quote, by describing yourself as black, you have started on the road to emancipation. You have committed yourself to fight against all forces that seek to use your blackness as a stamp that marks you out as a subservient being, end quote, and I thank you.